Have you ever been so deeply touched by an idea that you had no choice but to leave a comfortable existence behind and pursue it like nothing else mattered? Well, that's exactly what's happened to today's guest. And whilst it's still early days, he's on a mission to ensure that people who are sleeping rough get a comfortable, safe night's sleep. Before we get stuck into episode 420 of the award-winning Small Business Big Marketing Show, The Marketing Gold is made possible thanks to American Express. Now, it's made exclusively possible because for this and the next 3 weeks, Amex has kindly again taken all advertising spots. Check out their suite of business cards that really do meet the financial needs of small business owners just like you. Plus, Amex help in getting your business expenses to reward you, just like past guest Chris Gray does. He flies somewhere exotic about 15 times a year at the pointy end of the plane for free, excluding the odd airline tax. Simply Google Amex Business to find out more, then try and wipe the smile right off your face.
Well, I said, welcome to a small business marketing show, where successful small business owners share their souls to take your marketing straight to the lead. Now, here's your host, Mr. Timbo Reid.
And welcome back to the Small Business Big Marketing Show. I'm your host, Timbo Reid, but you, infinitely more importantly, are a motivated business owner ready to crank out some great marketing to build that beautiful business of yours into the empire it deserves to be. Big show today. Corporate cubicle escapee Simon Rowe shares why he left a cushy corporate job to start Sleepbus, a not-for-profit laser-focused on giving homeless people a safe night's sleep. Another motivated listener shares a marketing strategy that's working for them, and in return, I give them a prize or three. And as of this episode, each week, you and I are going to go back in time to when advertising jingles rocked. As per usual, team, there is marketing G-O-L-D dripping from the ceiling over here at Small Business Big Marketing's HQ. So let's get stuck right in. Got some great guests joining us in the coming weeks. We catch up with Carolyn Creswell, the founder of Carmen's Muesli, one of Australia's most well-known muesli brands, one which she started when she was just 18 years old. That's a great story. Speaking of great stories, Sean Dollinger, who's created the world's largest online marketplace for cannabis products, joins us as well. His business has been referred to in the media as the Amazon of pot. But right now, let's meet a fellow with a very big heart and a very big challenge ahead of him. 3 years ago, Simon Rowe left his cushy corporate job in a mahogany-clad corner office, you know the one, to start Sleepbus, a charity that provides fully decked-out buses to provide safe, temporary accommodation to those sleeping rough on the streets. Today, he has one fully operational Sleepbus in Melbourne and a vision to build 319 sleep buses, providing over 2 million safe sleeps per year all over Australia. I think we need more Simons in this world. In this extremely candid interview, Simon shares the moment he decided to escape the corporate cubicle and start Sleepbus, how a traumatic life event at the age of 19 laid the foundation for what he does, why he chose to be homeless himself in order to test this concept, how he's got Sleepbus to market in the first place, and how he's getting Sleepbus known in a pretty crowded marketplace of 600,000 Australian charities. Do we need another one? We'll find out. And we cover plenty more. I started off by asking Simon what he was doing prior to launching Sleepbus.
Prior to this, I was in the corporate world, so I'd had a business career. Yeah, it was a bit like that. Although I enjoyed it, I had a few businesses in my time, and then moved over into sort of consulting, I suppose, and helping other business people with their businesses, and then it sort of grew from there. And so I used to go in sort of as an operations specialist, sort of help people restructure the business and
see what's wrong. You're a bit of a Mr. Fix-It, I hear.
A bit of a fix-it guy, yeah. It sort of became that sort of thing. I just enjoyed digging into finding out what was wrong, and I ask questions and people like to tell me things as well, so which is good, so you can get to the bottom of things really easily.
Were you Jack of your corporate life?
No, not at all. No,
having a ball.
I was going all right. Yeah, yeah. It was quite successful. It wasn't. There wasn't any reason for me to get out of it. I had the lovely corner office with the glass and the view and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. So, earning
a good quid.
Yeah. Yep.
Great job. Not looking around.
No, not at all.
Not looking at starting a charity?
Absolutely not. 100% not. Even when I was looking into things, it was, don't start a charity. You know, there's too many already. The last thing we need is another one. And that sort of came out of my research as well when I was... Because when I was in the operations sort of game, part of my thing was sometimes I'd go undercover in a company and as an operations manager or just a BDM on the ground or something like that and go and speak to franchisees, speak to the C-suite guys, all that sort of stuff, and just sort of find out what was going on and just get everybody's side of it and then formulate a strategy from there. Mm-hmm. And then I'd present that strategy to the top people and then they'd say yay or nay and then we'd implement it and that sort of thing. So I went along with the same mindset with the charity. I was originally going to help some other charity that was already doing something in the space.
So that you had
my money, my experience, my skill set.
You had a bit of a mindset around maybe getting involved, a bit of a social conscience, but maybe not your own charity.
Yeah, social conscience, but only because I bumped into a guy that was homeless on the street one day. Yeah.
Okay, so tell us the story. How did Sleepbus come to be?
So it was Carlisle Street, which is a busy sort of trendy coffee street in St Kilda in Melbourne, and I was just heading to the Coles and to get some groceries on a Saturday, and it was a pretty gloomy day, but then there was a guy curled up in a bright white doona in the sort of doorway of a Bank of Melbourne, new branch that had just opened, and people were just stepping over him because it's sort of half out on the footpath, half in the doorway, and it just was one of those scenes. I don't know, I always say, you know, we've all walked past homeless people, we've all seen them, we've all walked past. And for whatever reason, this guy, this day, I stopped and I had a chat to him and I just remember him sitting up. I just said, you know, how you going, mate? I'm going to Coles. Can I get you anything? And just as I was talking to him, I just remember him he was just a tired guy. Like, he just looked so tired, his eyes. And look, I don't even think he would have been much past sort of early 30s, that sort of thing. But he looked, you could just tell that he'd had a hard time and didn't look like he was on anything or anything like that. He just looked tired, and I describe it tired to his core. So I ended up going to Coles. I got him some stuff, bananas and Coke and whatever else he asked for, some chocolate I think it was, and I gave him $20. And then I went home and my kids were home and I sort of said, I just explained this guy, you know, wow, this... couldn't believe how tired this guy was, and I started crying, and I don't cry. I'm not generally a crier, but I started getting tears in my eyes, and my boys were sort of like, oh, you should do something about that, Dad, and that was
how old are your boys?
They're 18 now, so they would have been sort of 15,
mid-teens,
16,
yeah.
So so when your kids say, you know, do something about it,
why did they say that?
Maybe because they thought I could, which I'd like to think. But also I think they were aware of the world and I think the fact that I was emotional about it as well, not that they'd not seen their dad cry, but it was just one of those experiences where I think I must have been quite passionate about it at the time and not that I thought of it at the time. And I remember people asking me in later times in speaking with people about, you know, why do you think you started crying? And I never really had an answer about why did I get the tears.
That seems an obvious question to me. I'm actually a bit of a crier, unlike you, Mr. Tough Guy. But
oh, no, no.
Isn't that an obvious question? It touched you.
Yeah, it did. It did touch me.
Did you see any of...
But I think people were trying to dig, you know, what's the deeper thing here and that sort of stuff. And
did you see any of this fellow in you?
Yeah, so that's where it sort of led. When I sat back and thought about it, I'd sort of forgotten that when I was 19, I was homeless for 4 months. And I had a job and my car engine blew up, drove it too hard as an 18, 19 year old and the engine went, but I needed the car to get to the job. This is in Adelaide. And so I spent my rent money to fix the car and then I got evicted. So, but I didn't panic. I mean, I was 19.
Where were your folks?
Oh, don't really sort of have those. So, Right. Yeah, so I don't have a close family network Okay. or anything like that. So it was just sort of me and Adelaide. I'd moved to Adelaide from country Victoria to play football, and that's how I sort of ended up in the city. And so, yeah, so I found myself living in that car that I fixed.
Tell me if I'm pushing. We didn't talk about triggers and safe words before we started the interview. But I am interested because... I tell you why I'm interested. A, I think you've done something amazing. You're doing something amazing. B, I think many people have had the thought of going and helping on a macro scale others, but most don't. You have. So I'm just trying to figure out what that is. So you've been homeless. You clearly must have seen. You didn't recognise it at the time, but this guy, that could have been you.
So that's what I think about now, and I think that's where the spine of Sleepbus sits, and what I'm trying to do with Sleepbus is I think about 19-year-old Simon, and had I not had that car, had I not had that job, what might have happened to me? So I was, and because I had the job and I had the car, I had mates, and I probably could have pitched in and lived in with my mates at their parents' house or something like that at the time, but probably too proud and thought and didn't think of it at the time that it was that big a deal. I just thought, oh, I'll sleep in my car. My mate used to drive past in the morning and toot his horn on his way to work, and I'd wake up, go to the local caravan park, jump over the back fence, have a shower and go to work. I just didn't think of any of it. Saved up my rent and bond to get into a house again four months later, and that was it. But I never, from that moment on though, it was like not finding myself in that situation again. Unfortunately, too many people.
Between that 19-year-old Simon experiencing 4 months of homelessness and you starting Sleepbus, can you reflect on times when maybe you were covering up an itch to get out of corporate and maybe do something at a more social level, at a social conscience
level? It's deep, isn't it? Gee. Yeah. I thought more about myself. Really, as far as, and like we all do, we want to make sure that we've got everything for our kids and we don't want to find our kids in that situation. So I was a dad first and foremost. And I'd done smaller things over that sort of 20-year period from then in the business world and that sort of stuff where I'd helped others or I'd taken in sort of giving kids their first shot at a job or something in a business that I might have had, just little things like that, but not consciously sort of reaching out to do that sort of stuff. But I think I was only thinking about it the other day and I was thinking that I think it just time and place. It was just that time where, and I also think that that the timing where I was in my own personal sort of journey and, you know, I'd had a successful career and, you know, I'd been lucky and I have a home and all those sorts of things. So everything was good. Timing was right. And particularly a skill set that I've gained over the years as well. So I'd had that experience with being homelessness, but then I've battled in small business. I've worked for big business. I've gone into the corporate stuff and battled there and learnt how to operate things and grow things and start things. So I think my skill set lent itself to fixing, like you said before,
your kids have said, righto, Dad, time to do something, do it. Tell me about the period of like hearing that from your teenage sons.
Yeah.
And doing something. And what did you do?
Yeah. So that was turn on the business brain, I think. That was the, okay, go with what you know, use your skill set, use this skill that you've built over the last sort of 20 years. So that was where I went into research. So I researched for 12 months. So I went into, okay, if I'm going to help somebody, I want to have an impact. Too many people sort of, you know, I'll give my $50 over there and that's it. Or I'll give my $2,000. That's it. Where did it go? Have no idea. And that's it. And I sort of thought, okay, well, if I'm going to have an impact, where could I most do that? And where does that impact need to be? So I, as I do in the corporate world, I went undercover as a homeless person a few times and stayed in some shelters to see what shelters were like.
How do you do that?
You put on your dirtiest, grubbiest clothes as the stereotypical homeless person people think they are, and lined up like everybody else. And I stayed in one place where it was just mattresses on a floor in a hall type thing, and that was the catalyst for Sleepbus. So I was allocated a mattress along with everybody else, a male only sort of place, and laid down, and there's obviously all kinds of people in all different types of situations and states, I suppose. And it was just scary. Like I was I was scared the whole night, and I didn't sleep the whole night. There was a bloke next to me who'd done it before, clearly, because as soon as his head hit the pillow, he was asleep and snoring. But then 30 minutes into that, people were going through his bags, and they were taking the shoes off his feet. And I was like, okay, safe sleeps. Like, how do I do safe sleeps? Like, how do you...
That was your moment, wasn't it?
That was my thing. And then when I looked into these shelters, bricks and mortar shelters and that sort of stuff, they are, like, no landlord wants them in their building. You can't afford to buy one, obviously, where you need to be. The cost to set one up and run it is just massive. So I had to sort of put my thinking cap on about, okay, so how do you provide safe sleeps cheaply? And then if you work that out, you've got to work out the marketing strategy for that. How do you then get people involved?
We'll come to that.
Yeah.
Just going back, dare I use a business term, but you got proof of concept on that night on a mattress on the floor in a very unsafe space.
Proof of where the solution needed to come, yeah.
You identified safe sleeping was the thing, not just sleeping, safe sleeping.
Yeah, so it was a door, somewhere where you could close the door.
Something that
simple. Well, you think if you have a curtain on your front door of your house... No. You're not going to sleep very well.
No.
And that's a lot of these places will have a curtain or nothing.
You said 3 or 4 nights in homeless shelters. What other research did you do? Are you a real quant guy?
I researched other charities. So I looked at not just in the homeless sector, but also who's doing what well. How are they doing it from a marketing business, a solution-based sort of theory. I spoke to some of the guys from Movember and looked at how they grew theirs and the mistakes they made early on, and they were telling me things that, you know, went wrong in the early days and what they had to change, and a lot of that was where the money went.
Did you speak to the Orange Sky Laundry guys?
Yeah, so...
Past guests of this show?
Yeah,
twice.
Yeah. So we did a few emails back and forth, and they wanted to come and have a look at Sleepbus and offered to, you know, do some laundry and that sort of stuff for the bus and that sort of thing. So it was... But that was a unique... experience, I suppose, because other organisations that I'd spoken to perhaps weren't as friendly. And that threw me, coming from the corporate world into this sort of new sector that I'd never... Because there's 600-odd thousand charities and they're all going for the same money.
So to that point, all very well to go, you've seen this homeless fellow in Carlisle Street, you've gone and identified the problem, and it's very clear to you that safe sleep is what it's all about. Ticking those boxes, but as you say, 600,000 charities in Australia. I think there's 55,000 registered not-for-profits. So either way, big
which
numbers.
Which Sleepbus is, we're one of those 55. So,
I look at businesses, I look at a cafe when it opens and go, really? Does that street need another cafe?
Yeah.
Likewise.
Or barbers at the moment. There's a lot of barbers.
And I see you've got a bit of work done up top there. So then how do you cross that one where you go, yeah, well, you know, charity's all about getting funding, volunteers from the public, from corporate sector, from government. You're going to be another one. Sure, Sleepbus has found maybe a gap that isn't being met, but what made you think you'd nail that?
Yeah, so part of the research sort of showed that you're established maybe those 55,000, but out of that, you know, maybe 5,000 of the top sort of lot that are bringing in the money and doing it well and have been doing it for a long time, so they're being established. The research shows that their donations come from your 20 to 65-year-old plus woman, and they donate. And that's where all the money comes from. And so I thought, okay, well, two things. One was, okay, well, that market's saturated in a business sort of thinking. But also, I don't want to step on people's toes. If that's where they're getting their money from, there's plenty of other groups out there and organisations and sectors that I can perhaps draw on to find engagement with. And part of that was I looked at high school kids and university kids. They're looking for something to engage with. They're desperately trying to find organisations to engage with because they want to change their world that they're seeing.
Millennials.
Yeah, that's it. And so I looked at, okay, so, and obviously I had high school age children, so I sort of used them as a bit of a target audience as well. And so I thought, if I can make a cool charity, how do I make a cool charity that these guys want to get involved with? And then how do I grab... And then extension of that, how do I get the young professionals on board who are then one day going to be the bosses of corporates and then get those corporates on board as well? So I didn't want to just go after that same market that everybody else did. So then I had to structure this charity before I even begun. How would that look? How would that operate? Right down to sort of target markets, but also where would our money come from? How would we run this organisation? And so I broke it up into three sort of groups. So we would obviously have the donations from people that wanted to support Sleepbus, and that would be one part of our revenue stream, if you like. The other part would be your charitable foundations and your corporates, so corporate sponsorship or some sort of support in that way, and then government funding along with our own. We need a social enterprise to be able to make our own money.
Yep.
To the point, though, that I wanted to bring that back, that we produced 2/3 of our own money, and then the rest was either from government or corporates, because I didn't want to rely. I found too many charities rely on the handout either from donations or government, and then when governments change or things change, economies change, they lose the funding.
Yep.
Everybody's out of a job. We can't run that program anymore, and I don't want to be in that space.
So you've done all your planning. You've figured out this is a good idea. You've got your marketing strategy in place. You know, you've got an idea.
Registered
of where
the charity before I started. Yep, all that sort of stuff.
You were still in corporate at this stage.
Yeah, I was. Yep. And then I launched, and then it was that proof of concept was launch the idea and see if other than me and my network thought it was a good idea. So I put it on GoFundMe to sort of see if I could raise money, $20,000 for a bus. And we raised over $100,000 in like 4 weeks.
Wow.
And it went global. I got phone calls from all over the world, like, how do we get a sleep bus in the US or England or Germany or all those sorts of places? And I went, whoa, okay. And that's kind of when the corporate job sort of started taking a back seat. And,
well, it gave you a bit of space, didn't it? You could kind of...
Well, I had to. It got to the stage where it was, you're gonna either going to have a crack at this sleep bus thing,
yeah,
or you're just going to forget it and go back to the corporate world. And I thought, I'll have a crack. And so I quit and went for it.
I bumped into a friend at Southland Shopping Centre today, and she said, what are you doing tonight? And I said, I'm interviewing you. And she said, I donated money to that GoFundMe.
Oh, there you go.
It was amazing.
Getting around.
So, okay, what do you do then? You got the money, you leave corporate. Tell me about the moment you walked into the boss's office. Was he up to, did he know or she, did she
it was
know
actually,
what you were up to?
It was actually review time, and I was sitting down for review, and I said, look, don't bother.
Don't bother.
I'm gonna call it a day, and here's what I'm doing, and that sort of stuff, and quite supportive. And
hard to argue.
Yeah, look, difficult to sort of say, good riddance kind of thing. It wasn't like I was going to the competition or anything. I was going to follow a passion and thought, and I kind of, like, I speak to school kids. I go to schools and university and things like that and speak all the time in conferences, and I sort of say, they say, why did you do it? And I sort of, I'm having a crack because I think I can. And I think if you think you can do something, have a go. I mean, so that was sort of where it was, and I was probably cocky enough to think that I could do something, so I thought I'd have a try. But
what do you do? Then you go, okay, I've got some dough. I've got a little bit of a runway, as the startup community talk about. You go and buy a bus and you dig
it
out.
That was the proof of concept then. So proof of concept for idea was established all around the world. We got news and all sorts of stuff. And then it was, okay, so then you got to build this thing and show people what the idea really is. And part of that research was that people have stopped giving to charity because they never believe the money goes where they say it's going to go. It goes to overheads and all that sort of stuff. And overheads are an important part of a charity.
Yeah.
Can't run them without that sort of stuff, but people don't like that. No, that's fine. And so part of that was, okay, put 100% of the public donations go directly to a bus, and you can see how that's built and that sort of thing. So on our first prototype bus, everybody's name that donated to that bus is on the back of the bus, all printed out, so you can go and see your bus. And so it was buy a bus and then fit it out and then test it, see if it's going to do what you thought it was going to do. And although I had a good design and I'd done a lot of research and that sort of stuff, until you actually test something.
No doubt.
And I couldn't, and that was the first stage, proof of concept, because a lot of people were, because this had never been done anywhere in the world like this before, so...
Which is amazing, really, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's one of those things where, is this done anywhere? And when you go and speak to council or governments, they sort of, I don't know about this one. We've never heard of this before. This is an odd way of doing things. And my theory was it's cheap. It's mobile. We can go where people need us. It's adaptable as far as if that group of homeless people move on from that area or they find themselves into housing and that sort of thing, we can move the bus somewhere else and we can grow where we need to.
We are chatting with Simon Rowe. He is the founder of Sleepbus. So, what do you call your clients, guests?
Guests.
What, just as a guest, treat me as a guest, what would the experience be? if I was to head into a sleep bus tonight. Yeah.
So part of that was it was about not having any restrictions. A lot of shelters and that will have restrictions on who can use it because they've limited space and you've got to give it to those that you've got to have a list basically because you've got to be able to have some reason to turn people away. And I found that counterintuitive to do that. And so my idea was we'll have one rule, which is quiet enjoyment. So it doesn't matter if you're on drugs or drunk or anything or perfectly well and healthy, just in a bad spot for the moment, as long as you can hold it together and stay quiet, enjoy your bed for the night, watch some TV because there's TVs in the sleep pods as well.
Just describe those.
Yeah. So, okay, so you come into the bus. So in the front of the bus, so there's a caretaker on the bus, so security type thing. I call it a caretaker because it's not a security guard.
Not a bouncer.
But it's not a social worker either. It's just somebody that's there to make sure everybody enjoys a quiet night's sleep and just protect you.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And so that person's at the front of the bus all night. And then at the front of the bus also, when you step up to go down the aisle of a bus, if you like, is two toilets. So part of that was security as well. It didn't want people to have to leave the bus to go and find a toilet. Let's keep them safe. Put them on the front of the bus where the security person is. If anything was to happen with anybody, any interactions, it would happen around the toilet. So I didn't want them at the back of the bus. I wanted them up the front to make it safe.
Makes sense.
And then where the chairs in a bus would normally be, they're all sleep pods. So they're about, they fit a person about 6'2", 6'3", so they're about that long. So it's a full single bed size and it has a roller door so you can lock your door and feel safe. It's got lights, air conditioning, an intercom to the caretaker, and it has a USB charger if you've got a phone, and it's got a free-to-air digital colour TV on the wall, just a small one, but the and people sort of saying, TVs, you know, it's a bit of overkill.
Why?
I think that's... but people are weird when you talk about this sort of thing, and or even if you show them the bus.
Someone sleeping rough is non-deserving of a bit of TV, are they? Show me those people.
Yes. How dare you? But then also people come from the perspective of, I sleep in my queen-size bed with my ensuite. Geez, these sleep pods are a bit small, aren't they?
Right.
Well, and I always... My go-to line is, it's better than sleeping on a park bench.
Correct.
So,
are these pods too high? Three high.
Yeah. So it is a comfy coffin. It's not massive, but I'm a fairly big bloke, so I'm 100-odd kilos, 6 foot, and I made sure that it was something... It's part of the design as well, and part of the reason for Sleep Bus was that it was supposed to be... this is a temporary measure. You need to find your steps out of homelessness. You need to figure out what it is. But I'll keep you safe and give you a good place to sleep until you do. So the pods are designed to be comfortable enough. So you will get a good night's sleep, but in the morning you want to get out.
You want to get out.
Because I don't want you to stay in because we roll away again.
So where do you go? Like, where do you...
Yes.
Where do you choose to go to find the people for the night to sleep?
It's not difficult.
And where do you park? No, yeah. I guess it's not. And where do you park for the night?
So, I mean, there was a situation where we were looking at Port Melbourne, St Kilda, because that's where I sort of originally had the idea, I suppose. And then I met with a gentleman that worked in child services and that sort of thing. And he said, oh, did you know about a group of people that sleep under a bridge in Docklands? And there's kids and mums and men and all sorts of stuff, and they're sleeping under a bridge in a foot of water on milk crates so that they stay out of the water. And I've got a bus with 22 beds in it. We can help people out. So part of one of the difficult parts was trying to get councils to give you permission to park because it's new. Mm-hmm. It's a risk for them. You know, I don't know what's going to happen with this thing. You know, how do we put our name to that sort of thing? And I managed to speak to some Uber executives in Sydney once at a conference, and they just said, look, our model is just go for it and beg for forgiveness kind of thing. The idea is to park in a central location where we need to be, so CBD, that sort of thing.
So it's generally CBD,
at this stage, because as we spread, I mean, there's need for buses in Ballarat, here in Victoria, in Bendigo, Pakenham, Rosebud, there's a large community.
And how do you know, like, do you just... Once it's full, it's full? Or do you have a loudspeaker going, sleep?
No, so it's funny. the homeless community is smaller than what you think, and they all right. know each other, and they all know what's going on the street and that sort of thing. So we park in the same spot every night. So the idea of sleep bus is that temporary thing, so we can roll in at 8 o'clock at night. And part of that was part of the marketing strategy, because a lot of people are like, I don't want a homeless shelter in my area, or I don't want this in my street, or I don't want this next to my building.
Do not get me started on this when
I know, it's annoying, but that's the thing I had to overcome.
Orange Sky Laundry, when I did a bit of work with them, parked out the front of one of those big fancy brands, fashion brands in Collins Street.
Yeah.
And, the security guard came out and said, you can't park here. Well, you can, yeah. And we will.
I mean, I'm torn as well, though, because I come from a business background, so I can sympathise with that side, but I can also sympathise.
Well, I can sympathise at a theoretical strategic yeah. level, yeah. but apply a little bit of humanity to your thinking and, pull your head in if you can't work it out.
So the idea with Sleep Bus is to park in the same spot each night uh-huh. so you know where to come to. And then if that's becomes a spot where we're just not filling the bus and there's a bigger group in, I don't know, Carlton Gardens or somewhere like that, wherever it might be, then we can move. We can move.
Wrap some numbers. Where's Sleep Bus out of the moment? How many buses you got? How many volunteers yep. you got? Tell us as much as you can.
Sleep Bus is still quite new. People think we're bigger and older than what we actually are. And I don't,
great marketing. We'll come to that.
Yeah, sometimes that's a good thing and sometimes that's a bad thing.
Yes.
So I've literally got one prototype operational bus, and that was the proof of concept. And part of my discussions, I managed to get in with some large consulting groups to have a chat about my strategy and what I need to do. One of their key things was you only get a chance to do this right once. So you've got to make sure that it's well tested, that it's, that it works beautifully and it's going to operate as it says on the tin kind of thing. And so the next stage now is we've got one and then the next stage is to build another two to show that we can operate a multi-site operation, mm-hmm. In three different areas.
Really cool. I want to talk about marketing. I have one interesting question before I do that.
Cool.
But you have done very well, because I look at your, I thought you had more than one bus. I knew you didn't have 10 or 20.
Yeah.
But your marketing, just even at a website level, it just looks professional. It looks, as a corporate person looking at that going, maybe I could throw a few dollars at it. It's very trustworthy.
Yeah.
You've got your story there. You've got pictures of the bus. I mean, it's just very well laid out. So therefore you think
Thanks.
You're bigger than you are. And you say that could be a problem, because therefore people go, it looks like these guys are sorted. We'll
yeah.
go and find another charity that doesn't look as sorted. So you're sort of torn.
Because there's organisations that support grassroots charities.
Yes.
Smaller charities that are just getting off the ground, or they're just a smaller charity. I'm actually one of those, but unfortunately we probably don't look it. So,
isn't that interesting? And,
yeah.
and the other part of that is you're out there. I mean, we had you on the Steve Price show the other night. You're out there, you're doing the media, you're willing, you're a good speaker, you're speaking at conferences or wherever. So yeah, it's that fine line between looking like you're desperate and looking like you got your shit together.
Yeah.
Tell me, before we talk marketing, you must have, I have to tread lightly here, but I think we've got a sense of humour as well, and I'm sure homeless people do. You must have
sure.
some very funny stories. Sleepwalkers, snorers, what I'm particularly interested in, is there any sleep bus babies just yet?
Oh, so they're individual sleep pods. So there's none of that going on. We do have pet pods underneath the bus as well.
They might have met on sleep bus.
There might be puppies, because we have pet pods underneath the bus, because a lot of homeless have companion animals.
Right.
And so and a geeky thing with that is we have an intercom between the owner in their sleep pod and the pet down underneath the bus. And people laugh at that. But then when I speak about that at conferences, all the pet people just go, oh isn't that
Charlie
lovely?
Buddy,
and they care more
awake?
About it.
Are you awake, puppy?
Yeah, well, they care more about the pets, the people, when I speak at conferences than they do about the homeless, which is,
well. Okay.
We've only really had part of the strategy. So I spoke to Victoria Police and Ambulance and the Fire Brigade and different organisations and councils, that sort of stuff, before I wanted to keep them in the loop about what I was doing and get advice. And obviously police are very risk-adverse sort of organisations, so they were worried about safety, and so safety was the big thing. And really the only time anything's ever gone wrong is just someone felt a bit claustrophobic.
Understandably.
And that's it. It's not a prison. You can leave. It's not going to be for everybody. And that was the thing, people sort of said, what if they don't like it? I'm just one solution.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, Sleep Bus was the part of my real thing was that affordable housing, which everybody talks about, is this buzz thing, but nothing ever seems to happen.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is definitely the way to go. And it's proved in other countries, Canada and places like that, where they've just built their houses and put people in it and it solved the issues and that sort of thing. But I looked at it from a business point of view that, yeah, building houses is definitely the way to go, but it takes a long time.
Yeah.
So we need to get them off the street first. So I'm looking at the foundation. I can build a bus in 6 weeks if I need to. Yeah.
Wow. It's potentially a 24-hour thing too. It doesn't have to be a nighttime thing, does it?
No. It's funny. I was at an entrepreneurs group conference a few weeks ago, and that was one of the questions. Oh, could you not operate it during the day as well and let people sleep in it during the day? And look, I haven't, because I use the bus as a marketing tool as well during the day. So I take it to schools and universities and corporates and that sort of stuff, show them the bus, do the talk, that sort of rattle my tin, whatever I got to do,
sure.
Which is a powerful thing as well. But I think part of it was, it's the same reason why originally on the TVs in my original design was the TVs were going to shut off, the power was going to shut off at midnight, because this is sleep bus,
yes.
Not stay up and watch TV up all night bus, yes. But then who am I to say you can't stay up and watch TV? You're on the street. It's bad enough without some guy coming in going, you can't watch TV. But also we think that, people sleep at the same hours that we do, but they don't.
Mm.
And so at this stage I've done it just at night, because that's the cycle I'd like to get people into, because the help you can get is during the day.
During the day, yeah. Well,
it's a tricky balance.
How has having Sleep Bus changed you?
Yeah, good and bad. It's a lot of work, and it's not that I didn't think it was going to be hard, but business is easier. it's one of those things. Oh, I think with business, when you've got a product or a service to sell, it's you can live and breathe and die on that product or service.
You've
that
got
sort
that.
Of thing. Yeah, I have. But then you're also asking for money without necessarily a physical return to the person, other than makes your heart feel good, which is still a good commodity and it's a good thing to have. But we're a consumer-driven society, so without getting everything that's returned. So part of it is, yes, you get a lot of one-time donations. So if I get some media, we get a push in donations. People hear about it, they go, oh, my God, how good's this guy? How good's that idea? And I love that, and I'm going to throw my $50 at it, and that's going to be great, and that'll do two safe sleeps and thanks for coming sort of thing. It's getting the ongoing consistency sort of thing. Because I'm at startup stage, I still need to have my hand out. I've still got to ask for the money
I want to finish on that. I do want to get – how has it changed you?
It changed me. Yeah, okay. for me –
are you avoiding that question,
no,
Simon?
No, it's not. No, it's a good question. And it's one of those things where I look at the corporate world now and – I'd have a very hard time going back. If Sleep Bus failed and didn't work, I'd just have to go back into business for myself. I don't think I could go back into the corporate world where, I don't know, I feel a little bit hollow about the whole thing. I helped a lot of corporates, a lot of franchisees, a lot of franchisors in my time, and it's just a cycle. Goes around. You hear a lot of stuff about franchisees or franchising at the moment, the good and the bad, and I was a part of that. And a lot of it just comes around in cycles, and so I feel a little bit hollow about just going back to a paid job.
So from a fundraising point of view, you've got a number of things on the website. It's $27.50 to donate. Anyone listening can go to sleepbus.org and donate. They're $27.50. That gets someone who's sleeping rough a good safe night's sleep.
Indeed.
You ask people to pledge their birthday, so don't give me presents, donate to Sleep Bus. I like that. You're asking people to do crazy or creative things to raise money.
Start a campaign and you raise the money for me, help me out sort of thing, and you've got a network that I don't know.
Yep.
So if you start something and do something, and it can be anything.
So let's finish with the corporate thing, because I noticed on your we're both from that part of life. We've both done it, and I've worked at a charity. You've got one. You got a lot of logos on your website. I'm guessing you've just put some, maybe a corporate's given you $100 for something, or another one's given you some strategic advice. Have you got a foundational corporate partner? And I'm thinking, what if 40 Winks? I'm thinking Sofitel.
Yeah,
I'm
hotels
thinking,
would
I'm thinking
be.
Hotels,
I'm looking
I'm
at hotels.
Bed retailers. I mean, surely.
Yeah, it's one of those. And again, it comes back to that proof of concept. I think a lot of, like, even back in the early days when I was talking about the idea before I put it on GoFundMe, I spoke to my corporate network. So I said, I've got this idea. What do you think? That sort of stuff. Have you got a bus yet? No. Okay, I'll get a bus, come back and talk to us. So it was kind of like, okay, so I'll get a bus, and then it's another thing. So it's proof of concept.
Can I just add to that? Dare I give you marketing advice?
Yep,
you're nailing it. But if you can, and I don't know how you find them, but you need to find someone in corporate that
has a passion.
That has a passion that has potentially been homeless before. That's going to be hard to identify. Who's going to own up to that?
Yeah.
But yeah. That's where the magic. I mean, I even find with the sponsorship of this podcast, if I find someone in an organisation that loves podcasting, that has a passion for small business and is a listener of this show, and it's happened on numerous occasions, then it's all good. We're in. It's I don't have to do the sell, and B, it makes for a really, really solid partnership because...
Great segue into marketing.
What's that?
Great segue into marketing, yeah. Only because one of the things I found in all the research I did, the planning, I nutted out a strategy from one bus to 300 because that's how many it would take around the country to get everybody off the street in this country.
Right? Jeez, I would have thought more, but yeah.
So it was a case of I tried to make this cool brand that that young people would get involved with, engage with, and look at a bus and go, man, that is cool. Like, I want to be a part of that. I want to come and volunteer. I want to donate my money. I want to raise funds. I want to throw a party. I want to do all this sort of stuff. The one thing I didn't count on, particularly when it comes to corporates, is homelessness isn't sexy. It's not a sexy charity. And that hurt. And I didn't see it. And that, so that's one of the things where you've... And then
can I just challenge that?
This is the world, though.
What's the thing happening at the MCG and all the sporting grounds? Sleep out at the G.
Yep.
What's that for?
So that's for the Selvos, I think.
For homelessness?
Yeah, it is.
That's a pretty cool event.
It is.
Thousands and thousands of people sleeping on sporting pitches around the country. The CEO sleep out.
Yep.
I would challenge you on that self-talk that homelessness isn't cool.
Yeah. Have you done it?
No, I haven't.
Okay.
Well, I know many who have.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a great networking opportunity. So it's a good networking opportunity. And the only feedback that I've had, and again, it comes back to we've got to prove ourselves. We're still new. We've got to show that it works and that sort of stuff, get more media, because I think that's when the snowball will start to happen.
Media,
because it's still very early.
Media will be key.
Yeah, it will be key. And part of that is that it then also, like, we won the Telstra Business Award for the Victorian Charity of the Year last year, and that was great because being such a new charity, it gave you some credibility. You know, they've been vetted. This isn't just some tin pot bloke we don't know who's got this dinky bus. It's not like that. We're actually...
Just being strategic about, have you not actually tactical about this, have you knocked on the door of all the bedding retailers in Australia, of all the hotel chains in Australia, of all the pillow manufacturers in Australia?
So...
Of the sheet, you know, like...
Yeah, so Tontine gave us all our pillows and doonas and sheets and everything for our first bus, and if I ask, they'll give it to me again. So there's gifts in kind, which is great. I approached some of the bigger bedding places because I thought, great synergy.
No-brainer.
What better charity than to have Sleepbus as your charity? But I think I went too soon. So it was while I was building the bus, I was talking about it. It was an unknown thing. So, again, that's where it comes back to the media. Like, I've just got to show more people what we're doing, get more buzz about it. Then I think the phones will ring hotter and it'll be a lot easier. Even winning things, I mean, I'd go back to the Telstra thing, but that just helped because when I rang places, they go, oh, yeah, I heard of you. Like your experience at Southland. Yeah, I've heard I donated to Sleepbus. I need more of that at this early stage because I am still very new.
Yeah.
Even though it may not look it, yeah.
No, mate, I reckon it's amazing what you've done. Given there's one bus there and you're 2 years in?
Yeah, from the time we launched our GoFundMe campaign. And
brilliant. I look forward to having you back on. I hope. Now, what I want you to do right now is, ask listeners to donate money, but is there one specific thing that's big and audacious and scary for you to even ask for?
Oh, it's not scary. I'll ask for it. That's not a problem. So, I mean, part of the to be able to get that snowball to roll on top of media is that then once the media rolls and we get that snowball happening that we need, I need to be able to churn out more buses. And I can't build them in winter in my backyard like I did for this first one. So part of it was looking for a site that we can... I will have a hard stand, a shipping container hard stand, and I'll build something on there if I need to. But I just need a somewhere close to Melbourne CBD that we can build buses, that we can reset them. So the idea was to keep costs down, was have one location, so obviously here in Victoria because that's where I'm based, where I can build all buses that we need. So our plan is to build 300 buses and launch them around the country.
What's the site? How big's the site? that you need?
Oh, look, beggars can't be choosers, but somewhere around 1,000 square metres plus. But
okay,
it can be anything,
an acre.
Piece of, yeah. And short of that, someone that will allow me to park the bus in their yard during the day so I can reset it and clean it and get some volunteers to come and help me with that. Not a lot to ask. I'm pretty easy.
Mate,
but
I won't say we will get that, but I hope we get that.
Any real estate agents out there?
How can they contact you, Simon?
So they can just jump on the website. Everything's on the website, so there's contact us. Because Sleepbus is just me. It's just one person. All emails, admin@info@accounts@, all comes to
all
me.
Comes so, to you. Sleepbus.org. Simon Rowe, thank you, buddy. Well done.
Appreciate it. Thanks so much.
Well, there you go, team. Sleepbus's Simon Rowe. What a story. If you know someone in Melbourne who can help Simon find that block of dirt he so desperately needs, then please do contact him via sleepbus.org. I've actually already got the wheels in motion on that, but many hands make light work. Sleepbus.org. Coming up, I share my top three attention grabbers from that fireside chat with Simon. Plus, in this week's Monster Prize Draw, another motivated listener shares a marketing idea they've picked up from this show and how it's positively impacted their business. And be sure to hang around until the end of this episode when I take you back to a great old advertising jingle from 1988. I'll give you a hint. It's for shampoo. But no fast forwarding, all right?
Here's a money-making tip from American Express member and Four Pillars Gin founder, Stu Greger.
I, for the life of me, don't understand why a business won't accept Amex, because what you're potentially doing is knocking back customers who want to spend money on your product or your brand or your service or whatever it is. And I frankly don't understand it. If someone wants to give me their Amex and buy 10 bottles of gin, I'll tell you what, I'll take their Amex, thanks very much. You're potentially also denying yourself a big chunk of corporate business as well, you know, because a lot of sales guys, a lot of guys, I know me in my own business, I use Amex. And if I go to if I ring to make a booking at a restaurant or a bar or something, I say, do you accept Amex? And they say no, I go somewhere else. So they don't even know the business they're missing out on. It beggars belief. And I often find myself having these rather awkward conversations at the with a shopkeeper or a bar owner or a restaurateur saying, why wouldn't you take it? I'll pay you the extra. I'll pay $1.50. Oh, the credit card service fee or whatever you want. Take my money.
It's business 101, really. Make it easy for people to give you money. Speaking of money, the American Express Business Explorer credit card comes with 50,000 bonus points every year, a low interest rate, and 2 points on every dollar you spend. Not to mention a couple of tickets to the very swish Amex Lounge at Sydney International Airport. Search Amex Business to find out more. New American Express card members only. Terms and conditions apply.
Righto, my top three attention grabbers from that chat with Simon Rowe of Sleepbus, thanks to American Express. Attention grabber number one. I love how Simon so clearly articulates the problem he's solving in two simple words, safe sleep. How clear are you on the problem you're solving for your precious tribe? If you think you've nailed it, then let me know. Leave a comment in the show notes over at smallbusinessbigmarketing.com/420. Attention grabber number two, Simon is also crystal clear on why he does what he does. The fact that he was homeless way back when he was 19 years old is clearly his motivation for putting everything he has into making Sleepbus an absolute success. So it raises the question, how clear are you on why you do what you do? Attention grabber number three, I didn't love some of Simon's self-talk. Phrases like homelessness isn't sexy may be true. I don't think it is, but he says it is. But reinforcing them in his everyday speak may be damaging to his dream in the long run. So what negative things are you innocently saying to yourself and others that may be damaging the way you market that beautiful and precious business of yours? Now, I know I said I'd give you three attention grabbers. I'm going to give you four. So attention grabber number four. Simon's hunger for media coverage is impressive. You wouldn't have seen this, of course, but he jumped at the chance for the interview. Then, as he was leaving the studio after the interview, which was done in at the radio station 3AW, I introduced him to another of the on-air hosts. He very quickly pitched his story, and very succinctly, I might add, and secured another interview on a national radio show. It was genius. So, what are you doing to secure some media attention for your business? That's what grabbed my attention. I'd love to hear from you. What grabbed yours? smallbusinessbigmarketing.com/420 is where you can tell me.
Come on down. It's Timbo's Monster Prize Draw.
Oh, yes, indeedly, doodly, it is that time of the week, the Small Business Big Marketing Monster Prize Draw, where we reward a motivated listener for taking action. You know the drill, but if you don't, if it's your first time around to enter, you've just got to email me, tim@timreid.com.au, telling me one idea you've implemented from listening to this show and what impact it's had on your business. If I read it on air, you'll receive a prize or two and go into the draw to win a hot lap in a racing Porsche with past guest and racing car legend Steve Richards. That's valued at $2,500. Righto, today's winner is Johnny Leary from brookfieldpoultryequipment.com. And here's what Johnny has to tell us. He says, hey, Timbo. Hey, Johnny, where do I start, mate? Probably at the beginning, Johnny. I've spent the past 12 years running my own building development company in Melbourne, and although I've slowly built up a property portfolio in that time, it's been a journey full of stress and cash flow issues, and I really needed a way out. I started listening to your podcast about 5 years ago on my way to Melbourne at 5 o'clock in the morning. Your interviews have inspired me so much that after every trip, I'd be excited about what the future could hold, and your upbeat style and mantra to follow your passion kept ringing in my ears. I tried to somehow integrate your teachings into my building company, but my heart wasn't in it and it just didn't work. Oh, okay. I won't take the cop for that, Johnny, because I think you've got some good news ahead. He says, 12 months ago, I found a very dated and underdone old business, brookfieldpoultryequipment.com, which is in a niche. I'm very familiar and excited about it as I grew up on a farm and have kept chickens in the backyard most of my life. After a 6-month negotiation, I took it over and have run it on the side since July last year. I love it when people buy underdone businesses and sort of improve the marketing and turn them into something special. Johnny goes on to say, then the floodgates could open. I scrapped the old website and set up a Shopify store. From there, I have worked on building a database and emailing useful content to them each week. Nice work, Johnny. I've started a blog and optimised them for SEO after listening to your interview with Rand Fishkin, one of which consistently gets me sales, one of those blog posts, obviously, that consistently gets him sales, now measurable through Shopify. And this year, I'm proud to say I'm leaving the building game for good and will go into the e-commerce world full-time. Wow, Johnny, impressive stuff, mate. I could go on and on about how you and your podcast have helped me, Timbo, but it's safe to say I have implemented a ton of ideas, and more importantly, because of your inspiration, I've completely transformed my life and am so excited about what the future holds, as this literally doesn't feel like work. Cheers, buddy. Keep up the awesome work, Johnny Leary. Johnny, mate, you keep up the awesome work. That is a great story. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for supporting my show. For that, you win a leather-bound exclusive Orbit key from past guest Rex Quo, valued at $99, and a backlink on the Small Business Big Marketing website, which I understand is priceless. Thanks, Johnny. If anyone else listening has an idea that they've implemented from listening to this show, email me, tim@timreid.com.au. I read it, you win. Now, given I cut my teeth for many years in Australia's largest advertising agency, this new segment may be a little self-indulgent. However, I do love the old advertising jingles, and I'm hoping you do too. Hearing them personally takes me back to a more innocent, playful time. Plus, the art of the jingle seems to have been lost these days as TV and radio advertising takes a back seat to online ads. So sit back and get all nostalgic as we pause for a commercial break.
Da, 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 corre, da, 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 corre, da, da, da. the correct, the correct, the correct.
Shampoo my hair.
Decorate.
I really love
decorate.
New decor. I love the feeling.
Decorate.
Nothing can be it. Oh, now. Yes, I. Shampoo.
I love that ad. I always found it a bit naughty too, especially given what the young lady was doing with the shampoo bottle at around the 20-second mark. You can watch it at smallbusinessbigmarketing.com/420. Well, I hope you found today's episode motivating. A little different to the usual chat, wasn't it? If you'd like to explore and be motivated by others who've gone down the charity route, then you'll love my chat with Nick and Lucas, who started Orange Sky Laundry, a charity that washes homeless people's clothes. In fact, after that interview, I went out on the road with them and recorded a second episode in which I hung out with some of their homeless friends to get their side of the story. You can find both those episodes plus hundreds more over at smallbusinessbigmarketing.com, or you can subscribe free on your favourite podcast app. Hey, I'd love to hear from you. Hit the contact button over at smallbusinessbigmarketing.com where you can email me, connect with me on social media, or grab a signed copy of my book, The Boomerang Effect, which is in reprint as we speak. A big thanks to American Express for sponsoring this episode. Search Amex Business to find out how your business expenses can reward you. And if you love the Small Business Big Marketing show, then let another business owner know about it by grabbing their phone, opening the podcast app, searching Small Business Big Marketing, downloading it for them, handing it back, saying you're welcome, and do that once a week for the next 52 weeks. I love you forever. Until next week, I'm Timbo Reid. Thanks for tuning in. May your marketing be the best marketing. Bye for now.